sorry for the confusing mess. I have a cold, so I'm going to be coughing my way through this introduction. As many of you know, this is the annual Queer Theory Lecture, which is sponsored by Program and Study Sexualities. And I think most of you already here know that we started this series to honor the late Eve Sedgwick, who, when she taught here at Duke, helped to forge this experiment in thought known as Queer Theory, and who died in spring 2009. We wanted to honor her, Eve's creativity and generativity in both scholarship and in teaching in a broad sense of her pedagogy. And I think Beth Freeman is a marvelous example of that combination. Her love of literature is reflected in incredibly close reading and also in a range of objects from alternative film to zines to activist movements. And it's attended to with a compassionate eye to the past, the future, and the present. Last week, and some number of us had a lively discussion about her recent book, Time Binds, her conscientious attention to time, her conversation with art and film, made me reflect, actually, on the sort of rationale for this annual lecture. Queer Theory thrives here at Duke University Press, the publishers of the leading queer theory journal, GLQ, which Beth co-edits with Nyan Shaw, and one of the major publishers of queer works, including Beth's 2002 book, The Wedding Complex, as well as her 2010 Time Binds. Beyond the press, though, I thought that Beth's exploration of time or temporality invited us to ask, what is our relationship to time in relation to queer theory itself, or vice versa? Could it be, in fact, a nostalgia for the heyday of queer theory at Duke, a heyday that we're now past, that we continue to hold on to a queer theory lecture? Is it grief? Is it the loss of Eve as a teacher and as a friend for many? Or that moment of creative innovation under the sign of queer that was here? Now, Beth's work, I should say, doesn't itself demand that the reader take such a neurotic or worrying reflection, perhaps during a prolonged cold that makes you even more neurotic and worrying. But because grief for Beth offers an embodied way of knowing time, and Beth's work allows us to work with the incommensurate, with the fragmented, with the partial. And so, following Beth, it seems to me that our ongoing project here at Duke in relation to queer theory makes sense not as the work of any particular individual scholar or two, or not as some private conversation among two or three interlocutors, but as something that opens up socially, if you will, like in this lecture, or in other experiments that don't have to be bound to any particular past lineage. What characterizes Beth's work, I think, in addition to that sensitive close reading of sound, visual, language, is the desire to think about queer as a method. She's clearly partial to queer objects, a sign of good taste if we believed in good taste, but her investments in political, relational, and erotic possibilities that are suggested by queer tendencies leads her to ask, how do we think queerly? How do we think about time in a way that isn't nihilistic, but isn't bound to the industrial clock or the baby's college funds? What helps us think queerly in this way, and where might we look for new, sort of, perhaps unanticipated places for inspiration? And I think that this commitment to method helps us think about queer theory as an ongoing and opening up and what I would say is a kind of social project. And I think that this investment in method is one of the things that we'll hear about today in her talk called Sacramental.
Will I change the rule?
Oh, well, she changed it. In a talk called Will I Change the Rule? Okay, Beth Freeman.
I met Eve once. I thrust some zines into her hands and squeaked, "You should read these," and then ran. Scared. But she was a huge presence in my life because I knew her graduate students. So in that sense, I knew her as a teacher, and of course I read her work, you know, with great joy and interest. So the working title of this thing is Sacramental Criticism and Unibomber's Nightwood. That's ended up being my touchstone text for thinking with, and I do have to have a text to think with. That's how I think. So I'll start with a couple of epigraphs. One is from David Halperin's How to Do the History of Homosexuality, and he asks, by virtue of what temporality Does sexuality have a history? And the other is from Michel Foucault, from a tape recording of him chatting with a hitchhiker in 1978 about the church and France. And Foucault said, "Entirely woven through with elements that are imaginary, erotic, effective, corporal, sexual, and so on, the church is superb." I want to begin. He didn't say that. I want to begin with a reminder that the entire history of sexuality of the Western discourse, if we are to believe Foucault, emerges from the Catholic sacrament of penance and reconciliation, popularly known as confession. And I'm sure there isn't a person in this room who is unfamiliar with Foucault's description of confession as an incitement to discourse, a technique through which the sexual subject is confirmed as such by an authority's demand that she speak her desires. So in Foucault's account, the rite of confession gets dispersed into a variety of state apparatuses in the 18th century, which produce sexuality as a domain of knowledge and of truth. What I find fascinating about this narrative is the question of what happens to the sacramental aspects of confession as it is secularized. What happens, that is, besides the loss of God as an authorizing force? Confession initially appears as one of seven Catholic rites and rituals understood to be reenactments of Christ's actions, renewing the bonds between Christians with one another and between each Christian and God, and conferring grace upon those who receive them. There are three sacraments of initiation: baptism, confirmation of the Eucharist, which bring participants into meaningful connection with the divine and with one another as people of God. There are two sacraments of healing, penance and the anointing of the sick, which extend Christ's power to heal and save. And there are two sacraments of service to others, ordination to the holy orders and marriage, which are evangelical at heart insofar as they confer the particular mission to build up the people of God. Of these seven Roman Catholic sacraments, five are not fundamentally tied to speech. They have linguistic elements, but are not completely made of words. In fact, the central action, what the Catholic catechism on the Vatican webpage calls the essential rite or sign of speech, the thing that makes it what it is, involves a material object. So for baptism, the candidate immersed in or splashed with water. For confirmation or First Communion, the candidate is anointed with oil of chrism. For the Eucharist, the participants take the bread and the wine. For the anointing, the sick or the dying are anointed with consecrated, I'm having talking problems, with oil of the infirm. And for holy orders, the bishop places usually his hands on the head of the ordinant. In all of these cases, without the water, bread, wine, oil, or laying on of hands, the rite is incomplete. This is because, in Roman Catholic theology, the essential rite is crucial, not insofar as it points outside itself to the idea or the doctrine of divine grace, but insofar as it actually manifests and confers divine grace. In this sense, the sacrament is not even a reenactment of Christ's actions, it is Christ's actions to be placed in the present. Ironically enough for queer studies, only two sacraments are fundamentally verbal: marriage and penance. In the Catholic Catechism, the essential rite of marriage consists in the performative words of consent, "I do." Rings and a kiss may be offered as signs of this consent, but it is the spoken words that actually affect the union of the couple with one another, with Christ and with the church. Obviously spoken in front of a priest, but the words. Similarly, while the sacrament of penance and reconciliation is not without its visible signs, symbolized as it is by the keys to the kingdom and the scourging whip, and accompanied as it can be by the priest extending a hand over the supplicant's head and making the sign of the cross, since the 12th and 13th centuries, its central actions have been utterances, the confessor saying the words and the priest responding with absolution. So this is from, again, the Catholic Catechism. The elements of the celebration are ordinarily these: a greeting and blessing from the priest, reading the word of God to illuminate the conscience and elicit contrition, and an exhortation to repentance. The confession, which acknowledges sins and makes them known to the priest, the imposition and acceptance of a penance, the priest's absolution, a prayer of thanksgiving and praise and dismissal with the blessing of the priest. So, penance, despite the lush set of physical practices that the penitent may or may not take up outside the confession booth, is the least sensorially rich of the sacraments. It involves utterance and only utterance. To my eye, it is telling that the two most speech-bound sacraments, marriage and penance, are the linchpins of the regime of sexuality, in which the thicket of terms, concepts, and techniques attending to non-reproductive erotic acts grows ever more fulsome, and marital relations become tacit. In other words, the self-evidence of marital relations is a corollary to the flowering of discourse, including but not limited to speech, about sex. And both regimes emerge from fundamentally verbal sacraments. My question then is this: what if we think about other possible formations of eros and desire? Not histories of sexuality per se, but emergent, residual, even imaginary relationships to bodies, practices, fantasies, urges, through a truly sacramental imaginary. That is, one in which speech does not trump and aim to manage the senses. By sacramental, I mean something like this. One, emphasizing the tangible. Two, participatory. Three, effective of non-conditional forms of relationality. And four, crucially, trafficking in historiography, or at least in pastness, in profoundly different ways than what we know as secular history. The stakes of this, I would argue, go beyond the queer impulse to imagine the past otherwise. As, I believe, your colleague, David Ayers, has discussed in great depth, the most recent innovation on the way that literary and cultural critics practice the analysis of history, new historicism, was elaborated by Catherine Gallagher and Stephen Greenblatt in direct opposition to the sacraments and to sacramental ways of thinking. They equated the sacraments with sterile and ahistorical formalism as opposed to living and vital history. I think it may not be a coincidence, then, that an anti-sacramental new historicism, paradoxically enough inspired by Foucault, has not been particularly hospitable to queer theory. That it has taken a generation of queer theorists trained under new historicism some time to formulate other ways of doing and thinking history. And here I would like to hail Christopher Nealon as perhaps the first of this kind of second wave of queer historiographers in his book Foundlings. Despite this shift, I think we have not yet arrived at enough new ways to do the history of sexuality. And I'm going to gamble that forgetting Foucault, as David Hoffman puts it, means reinserting the right of confession back into the hermeneutic apparatus that it is part of, and seeing whether other historiography of sexuality arises, or what it might mean to do the history of sexuality via a different temporal, and I would add, visceral mode. So, back to the question of what makes the sacramental. Consider first tangibility. According to the Catechism of the Catholic Church, a sacrament is defined as a perceptible sign authorized by Christ, symbolizing and affecting God's grace. And the Catechism emphasizes over and over again physical signs and symbols, visible creation, signs taken from the social life of man, reminding believers that, and I quote, the liturgical word and action are inseparable. These are the smells and bells of Catholic and High Anglican services, the aspects that engage the senses. Second, the sacrament is participatory. As Regina Schwartz writes in Sacramentality at the Dawn of Secularism, a sacramental understanding of participation enfolds the reader or viewer into this process. He participates in its discoveries, seeing what it sees, hearing what it says, feeling what it feels. No mere spectator of the work, the viewer is changed during his encounter with it. In this sense, a sacrament is both sign and instrument, both communicative and transmissive, indeed performative. Third, the changes effected in the viewer are not merely a technology of the self, in Foucault's terms. They not only confer individual grace, but bind participants into a formation, the body of Christ, which is crucially never fully realizable in the earthly terms of kinship and belonging. The transformation is, in many ways, about personhood moved into the other, not through the individualizing work of the Christian pastoral, or solipsistic self-shattering of asceticism, but through changes in the sensorium. And I'll go on to argue that the sacraments actually accord more with Foucault's model of friendship as a counter to the regime of sexuality than they do with his other major antidote, sadomasochism. Finally, a sacrament is also a temporal effect, both commemorative of the events that preceded and prefigurative of the events to come. In his essay, The Premodern Condition, Bruce Holsinger has described the sacramental sensibility as one which, quote, functions in discrete past events and surviving relics, the wondrous promise of an invisible totality it can only occasionally glimpse in the late present. In other words, the sacrament takes up something acknowledged to have happened and uses that fragment as a prismatic lens for two things. For the fleeting presence of utopia in the now, which Jose Muñoz has taught us to see in his book Cruising Utopia via Ernst Bloch, and for a peek at the kingdom of heaven that awaits believers in the future. Is there, then, an epistemology of the chalice? By resurrecting the term sacramental, Holsinger points towards ways of knowing that include desires, bodies, and fantasies, and which the stridently secularized historicisms of continental theory tend to disavow or displace. Indeed, in their introduction to their anthology, Secularisms, Janet Jacobson and Anne Pellegrini argue that secular modernity's signal feature is a misunderstanding of its own worldview as a-religious or anti-religious. Only if we identify religion as primarily a structure of abstract belief rather than a set of knowledge practices and embodied rituals, they write, can we achieve a supposedly atheistic modernity. In secular modernity, then, religion itself appears as faulty theory. We can see this in the way that Gallagher and Greenblatt set up the new historicism as an antidote to the textual idol worship of the new criticism, which they analogized to sacramental thinking. But religion is equally well understood as habitus, Pierre Bourdieu's term for a bodily as well as a mental disposition toward the world. And the habitus of secular modernity, as Jacobson's and Pellegrini's reading of Weber reveals, has deeply Protestant origins. It consists of a worldly asceticism comprising both a sign of salvation and a requirement for making a profit in the market. We may live in a world where God is dead, but as moderns who still connect aesthetics to the profit motive and to eventual gratification in definitively Protestant ways, we hardly live in a post-enchanted world. In light of Jacobson and Pellegrini's analysis, I would argue that Foucault's focus on the complex of confession, penitence, and asceticism may have produced a deeply Protestant history of sexuality despite his own Catholic background. What might a more Catholic, capital and lowercase c, vision enable or reveal, if not as a history of sexuality, as a counter-history of erotic and historiography of bodies and pleasures? Whether consubstantial or transubstantial, the sacrament is about doing things with things rather than with words, about sensing or encountering an other one cannot know with the mind alone. It is the form of Hans-Georg Gadamer's concept of theoria, a true sharing, quote, a true sharing, not something active, but something passive, pathos, namely, being totally involved and carried away by what one sees. Here, theory, thought through sacramentality, is deeply like sexual bodily, less a sign of mastery than the result of a certain enthusiastic surrender. It is also more like a devotional practice than like a portable toolkit, for devotional ritual must stick to its object, retaining both the body of the devotee and the object of devotion, or it becomes just a doctrine, commentary about God rather than an experience of God. We are not supposed to do this sticky thing with theory. And as a sign of theory is precisely its ability to transcend the object that has occasioned it. Yet, Eve Sedgwick has suggested that the very adherence to objects and texts is fundamental to queer analysis in her piece Queer Now, which I'm going to be talking about with Rob Newman's undergraduates tomorrow. And I want to pause here to say that there is, of course, another way that one could go with this question of what happens to histories and theories of sexuality when we detour from the confession and towards other sacraments. We could, of course, move away from all the hierarchical, doctrinal, and unremittingly Christian association of the sacraments and towards, say, mysticism, Eastern or Western, or even Anglo-American ecstatic religions such as spiritualism or the Shakers. For the first, I argue that Western mysticism, at least, is bound up in a fantasy of God's immediacy, access, and presence. So I'm talking about specifically about Western mysticism. Or in a belief in the immediacy of the body sensations and sort of an attempt thus to fit to circumvent the figural domain. I most emphatically do not conflate the figurative with the linguistic or the discursive, but figuration is a mode of mediation, and mediation is, as we know, inevitable. Furthermore, mysticism has provided a powerful way to think about the female religious experience, but the conflation of femininity and bodily immediacy does not strike me as especially fruitful for queer theory, when queer is, it seems to me, fundamentally about reconfiguring rather than abolishing the science. For the second way of connecting sexuality to the sensory, I'm just going to point you to the work of historian Molly McGeary, who in Ghosts of Futures Past tracks a counter-history of sexuality in Anglo-American ecstatic religions, most notably spiritualism. Now, one thing that that book reminds us of is the very different way that Eros looks when it circulates through what might be called post-Protestant American Christianities. The history of sexuality is a very European history, and part of what's exciting about doing Americanist work in the field is how very different an American genealogy of sexuality looks. But given Foucault's paradoxically atheistic Catholicism, I'm not entirely ready to throw out the bathwater of Catholicism's smells and bells with the twin first stages of marriage and penance. What interests me about the Catholic / Anglican sacramental imaginary is that it places such a premium not just or not solely on the mediation of priest and church authority, as the Puritans complained, but on the figure, the gesture, the object itself, and on the devotee's contact with it. This may be a legacy of Catholicism's historical strategy of incorporating local so-called pagan practices, but it is also a way toward negotiating between the strongly materialist impulses of historicism and the strongly theoretical and philosophical impulses of queer critique, between structure and the fragment, between concept and style. While certainly not an ars erotica, the five most sensate sacraments that I described insist on the question of how to do things, if not beyond or without words, with figures and objects, if not with magic, with a kind of non-secular enchantment that can attend to queerer formations of bodies and histories than the confession enables. My key text, and I'm going to go literary on you, for working through this question of how to do critical things with sacramentality is Juna Barnes's Nightwood, a text shot through with religious language and imagery, one that seems at once to scathingly reject both the confessional and the marital, and yet to long for some other mode of knowledge and power than secular modernity provides. To begin with, Nightwood is a novel about two doomed interfaith relationships. The first is the marriage between a man of Jewish heritage, Baron Felix von Folkbein, and a Catholic convert, Robin Vogt. The second sort of doomed relationship is the love affair between Robin and a cultural Protestant, Nora Flood. The Baron marries Robin, but then Robin meets Nora at the circus, and the two are instantly drawn to one another. The bulk of the novel consists of monologues about their torturous affair, in which Robin leaves Nora for another woman, and then for no one at all, preferring to wander the streets than to be in a stultifying domestic partnership. The Protestant-Catholic dichotomy between Nora and Robin is not incidental to the novel. Matthew O'Connor, the man whose monologues comprise much of the novel, describes Protestantism as, quote, the girl who loves you so much that you can lie to her, unquote. And Catholicism as, quote, the girl that you love so much that she can lie to you, unquote. And the novel's two tragic women match these descriptions exactly. The Protestant Nora is the girl who loves Robin so much that Robin can and does lie to her constantly. The Catholic Robin is the girl so beloved to Nora that Nora prefers to be deceived rather than abandoned. And this Protestant-Catholic binary has everything to do with the novel's deprivileging not only marriage, but also confession in relation to the other sacraments and what they can do. It's easy enough to read Nightwood as a scathing rejection of the marital life, insofar as the one marriage in the novel is a disaster, and insofar as even lesbian couplehood is a scene of suffering and deadlock. But the literary critic Laura Feldman has also illuminated for me just how central and antipathic the rite of confession is to Barnes's novel. So I'll say a little bit about confession in the novel as a way of getting to the other sacraments. First, of course, the novel turns over and over again to the motif of genuflection, of bowing down or going on one's knees. So, in fact, the original title of Nightwood was Bow Down, and that then became the title of the first chapter. Another example, both Baron and Nora spend their time, quote, going down before the impending and inaccessible, unquote. In the Baron's case, this is the idea of nobility, and in Nora's case, this is Robin. And then Nora goes down on her knees in horror when she perceives Robin with another lover. And I'd like to read this motif of sort of going down more literally than critics who've read it as a metaphor for degeneration. And I'd like to think of it as a kind of eroticized religious supplication, where going down and being on one's knees signal both penitence and bottoming. The second way confession is thematized in the novel, as Feldman points out, is in the figure of Matthew O'Connor, the garrulous Roman Catholic cross-dressing faith gynecologist, who acts as Nightwood's priest insofar as the novel's suffering characters, i.e. Robin's lovers, run to him for explanations and absolution. And third, perhaps what is Nightwood's most moving scene is figured not just as a confession, as Feldman demonstrates, but actually as an avatar for the role of confession in the regime of sexuality. So Nora comes to Matthew's apartment to ask him, Watchman, what of the night? And that's the title of the chapter. In his position as watchman, Matthew emblematizes what Foucault calls the Christian pastoral, the beneficent, all-seeing shepherd who will sacrifice himself, if necessary, for his sheep. The tiny one-room space he lives in, strewn with women's garments and rusty gynecological tools, also visually condenses Foucault's notion of the confessional as at once a closet and a precursor of the science of sexuality. Fourth, Matthew himself confesses twice. First, overriding Nora's questions and comments with his own sort of torrential prose. If you've read the novel, you know what I mean. And next, he goes to an empty church to masturbate, or what he, the way he describes it is, he pulls out his penis and he makes it, quote, face the mystery, so it, the mystery, could see him, the penis, as clear as it saw me, unquote. So Matthew lays bare not so much his sin as his state of morphological abjection. But he also seems to proffer up his penis as a gender-normalizing penance for the transgender subjectivity and cross-dressing that God sees but cannot see through. Feldman's reading accords with my own sense that Nightwood is vehemently opposed not to the confession per se, but more to its role as linchpin in Foucauldian incitement to discourse. For despite bearing his soul to Nora and his penis to God, Matthew finishes his chapter-long monologue of Go Down with Matthew with the statement that, quote, I've not only lived my life for nothing, I've told it for nothing, unquote. Instead of privileging the discourse of sexuality, then Nightwood follows Heather Love's model of turning backwards to an imagined moment before desires, practices, and fantasies were collated and calcified into identity. So before stancia sexualis. Nightwood goes down not only spatially onto its knees before mystery, but temporally into a time before recorded history. And as Catherine Bond Stockton clarifies, the time before the hetero-homo divide is stroked in the novelist prehistoric, as a time prior not only to writing but to memory, and specifically as the time of animals. This is the major trope governing the novel's inhumanism, specifically its antipathy toward the regime of sexuality. And Foucault writes, and I love this, it is not through sexuality that we communicate with the orderly and pleasingly profane world of animals. By turning toward the animal as a way of turning away from the sovereign human subject made intelligible through the technologies that emerge from the confession, Nightwood initially seems to turn toward a place that queer theory has more recently gone to, toward what we have learned to regard, what we have learned to regard in shorthand as the antisocial thesis. Robin is vote is the novel's avatar for the antisocial. She figures at once the night, the damage wrought by the incitement to discourse, the lure of anti-identitarianism, and ultimately a mode of becoming human, inhuman, that is fundamentally and paradoxically about avoiding risk, chewing figuration, thereby ultimately actually not where I want to go with this novel. But here are some examples of Robin's antisocial qualities. On the night and the anti-identitarian. Noor remarks that, now I see the night does something to a person's identity even when asleep. On the Bible of this course, Matthew describes Noor's fatal error vis-a-vis Robin as, quote, dressing the unknowable in the garments of the known. On the Inhuman, Robin first appears in a faint in her apartment, figures a plant. Her body smells like fungus, her flesh has, quote, the texture of plant life. There is this phosphoric, this word, glow around her head. The narrator analogizes Robin to a beast becoming human, yet this process is incomplete as, quote, she yet carried the quality of the way back, as animals do. And finally, on the question of the antisocial thesis, Robin powerfully echoes some of the Edelman's most transient formulations of queerness. She rejects children, abandoning her son and threatening to smash the doll that Nora Flood gives her as a symbol of the children they cannot have. She lets her pets die. Not only does she foil generationality even across the boundaries between people and objects, people and pets, refusing to mother anything, she has a past at all, unlike her husband, Baron von Folkbein, who has made up an aristocratic past to hide his Jewish heritage, or Nora Flood, who is consistently analogized with American history. Being so far outside of history, Robin has no future either. Felix remarks that to pay homage to our past is the only gesture that includes a future. And Robin pays homage to nothing, least of all to the past. So in her refusal to be intelligently human, Robin is fundamentally not just antisocial, but asocial. The novel refers to her, quote, unpeopled thoughts. And Noor realizes that Robin, quote, can't see herself in another's place. She herself is the only physician. Robin knows she is innocent because she can't do anything in relation to anyone but herself, unquote. Indeed, Robin is the living emblem of Lacan's injunction that there is no such thing as a sexual relation. I've said that the antisocial thesis is about an aversion to figuration. Most abstractly, then, Robin's desirability lies in the impossibility of turning her into a thought. Baron Felix remarks, I never did have a really clear idea of her at any time. I had an image of her, but that is not the same thing. I'll come back to the question of that image, but for now, let me register Baron Felix's consternation that Robin is irreducible to an idea. Overall, Robin's becoming animal is less about degeneration or departure from history or even identity than about the fantasy of being unrepresentable, about an iconoclasm which is, I think, the basis of the antisocial thesis. We can see that iconoclasm in Bersani's formulation of jouissance of the mode of aesthesis. There's that rite of penance again, right? Where anal sex serves to shatter whatever image the self has, whatever image of the self has suffered the ego. We can see it in Edelman's sense of homosexual, which denotes a fundamental resistance to meaning and intelligibility. But I find these formulations unsatisfying in that they are merely the flip side of the same point of discourse. They are part of that complex of asceticism, sadomasochism, and the transgression of the limits of selfhood that Foucault initially offers up as modes of resistance to the regime of sexuality, but that ultimately depend on the latter for their meaning. What I hope to do here instead is to offer up what I've called the sensate sacraments as another very different way out of sexuality, not through the universally admired androgyne Robin Vogt, but through the much more difficult, pathetic, and anti-heroic femme, Nora Flood. So, to recap a bit. Thus far, what I've been experimenting with is the idea that we find in the sacramental the origins of the regime of sexuality, albeit in the least figurative, gestural, and tangible of the sacraments, the confession. And that isolation of the confession from its place among the lushly sensate sacraments is an analytic loss. To my eye, the antisocial thesis likewise privileges the sacrament of penance at the expense of other sacramental modes, and constitutes a somewhat reactionary queer theoretical drive toward a high modernist politics of the non-representational, which is still, in the very model of self-shattering that it privileges, actually very much bound up in the self it seeks to jettison. Finally, though we might see any version of historicism as a corrective to the anti-formalism of the antisocial thesis, the new historicism too participated in this suspicion of representation, this assumption that iconoclasm is good and iconophilia is complicit with repressive power. Confounding sacramentality with formalism and historicism with anti-formalism, the new historicists made it impossible to think of form as a way into history. But Robin's becoming animal can be read as something other than high modernist anti-representationalism, as Catherine von Stockton's book, The Queer Child, understands so beautifully about the novel. Robin can be read, in fact, in terms of a decadent or even surrealist commitment to over-figuration, to making metaphor, to lateral movement, to new ligaments between sign and sign, as in the example that Stockton cites, my mother is my dolly. In characterizing Robin as unable to be thought, as someone about whom he never really had a clear idea, Felix remarks that an image is a stop the mind makes between uncertainties. So if Robin cannot be an idea, she can be an image, a relic, a thing to which ideas stick. While the novel certainly privileges uncertainty, it is especially interested in an overproductive of these imagistic stops and the function they have in binding humans to one another beyond their will and beyond the properly political and historical. In this sense, then, I think Knightwood tarries in a post-theological sacramentality. In the perceptible sign as effective and affective across secular social bonds and temporality. And I'm not surprised that it would be Catherine von Stockton, who was once an ordained Episcopal priest, who would bring out the sacramental in this novel, though she does not call it that. Knightwood then invites the question of what happens to queer theory and theories of sexuality if you move out of the confessional and into some of the other sacraments. Or, following Derrida's Religion Without Religion, the novel asks, might there be such a thing as a sacramentality, a way of thinking with the sacraments without the surety of God's grace or even of God? If the regime of sexuality originates in the confessional and finds a pseudo-oppositional corollary in both SM and the existential thesis, we can, of course, follow Derrida's work on hospitality and wonder if friendship, that other thing that Foucault posited as homosexuality's real work on the world and against the regime of sexuality, resonates in other sacraments. Though Foucault's model friends are notably Greeks, it is startling to see what aspects of other relationality are encompassed by the two other sacraments manifest in Knightwood, baptism and the Eucharist. These are, of course, the only sacraments that the Puritans wanted to keep, which makes me want to hazard the idea that Knightwood is in many ways actually a Protestant, not a Catholic novel, despite its connections to a decadence that is supersaturated with Catholicism. But it is not a novel that follows the logic of asceticism and anti-creduality commonly associated with Protestantism. It follows the logic of the host, which is to say, of giving place to the other without asking reciprocity. Yet it does so not from the privileged position of the one who extends the sacrament, but from the position of the one who is the sacrament, the eaten and not the eater. Ultimately, in Knightwood, the logic of the Eucharist overtakes the logic of confession. I've said that to depart from the confession means returning to the sensory aspects of the sacraments, which is oddly a way of moving back towards Catholicism. As the controlling voice of the novel, Matthew O'Connor aligns Protestantism with the word and Catholicism with the sensory, figuring Protestantism in terms of not only lines, as I mentioned earlier, but also talking. He asks, what do you listen to in the Protestant church? To the words of a man who has been chosen for his eloquence. And he finishes by stating that the Protestant outlook, quote, is hard as the gift of gab. By contrast, he figures Catholicism as a race. It's already in your blood, he says. He gives Catholicism the visceral qualities missing from Protestantism, describing the Catholic sitting boldly with his goats, and finishing with a statement that in contrast with Protestantism's hard gab, Catholicism is, quote, as soft as a goat's hip. But then, just as these distinctions seem firm, they merge in the figure of the Catholic confessional, where, quote, in sonorous prose, lacking contrition, if you must, you can speak of the condition of the knotted, tangled soul, and be answered in Gothic echoes, mutual and instantaneous, and be forgiven, unquote. In other words, if Catholicism originally seems promisingly carnal, the confessional reduces it to hollow echoes. What, then, does it mean to say that Catholicism, perhaps even Christianity, is in the blood? How can Christianity be sanguinary when it has been so consistently theorized and theologized as a form of sodality beyond biological kinship? My answer will be this, first by water, and then by blood. First, I think we are invited to consider Protestantism beyond talk, beyond the incitement to discourse, specifically through the figure of Nora Flood. Matthew describes Nora as, quote, a religious woman without the joy and safety of the Catholic faith. Take that safety from a woman, and love gets loose and into the rafters. She sees her, Nora, everywhere. In other words, surprisingly enough, Nora the Protestant is a figure of love getting loose through a proliferation of signs, through overfiguration, through a flood of things beyond words. And it's this that I'm aligned with a queer vision of sacramentality. Nora is the character who invites us to Christianity has, paradoxically, a relation with shared fluid. So one baptism. The name Noah flood echoes the Old Testament. Noah's flood is itself a prefiguration of baptism. A minor character remarks in the novel's opening chapter, and excuse my German, "Wir setzen an dieser Stelle über den Fluss." We are set out of this place here over the river, I think. My translation is bad, you can talk to me afterwards. While the allusion is to the river Styx, I think, the flood of passion upon which the novel rises memorized. Early on in the novel, Nora sees a line of discourse. An early Christian, she believed in the word, we're told. But this association of Nora with words morphs into an association with water. Matthew declares that Nora is, quote, of a clean race, a too eagerly washing people. First, it's notable that Matthew describes Protestants as a race, as if washing confers enough bodily likeness upon the washers that they may be thought of as a people, with water replacing blood. Matthew later declares, quote, "We wash away our sense of sin, and what does that bath secure us? Sin, shining bright and hard. In what does a Latin bathe? True dust. We have made the literal error. We have used water. We are thus too sharply reminded. The Anglo-Saxon has made the literal error. Using water, he has washed away his page." But though this passage nicely skewers the Protestant range for spiritual and physical hygiene, oddly, here, baptism washes away the page, the word. The literal error is a positive one. Even Matthew eventually redeems baptism for something we would recognize, and the novel insistently tropes as queer, the night. This is Matthew. "I'm an angel on all fours, with a child's feet behind me, seeking my people that have never been made, going down face foremost, drinking the waters of night at the waterfall of the damned. And I go into the waters, up to my heart, the terrible waters." Here, the sacrament of baptism is an act of, quote, seeking my people that have never been named, of gathering at the font with those whom Christianity has cast out, of going into these unseen waters, not to be forgiven, but to be conjoined with something, someone, somewhere beyond the secular imagination of humanity. And we see this sociable aspect of baptism enacted in the novel's consistent linkage of humans and animals through water. Robin first appears to us figuratively immersed, quote, "as if sleep were a decay, fishing her beneath the visible surface. About her head, there was an effulgence as of phosphorus glowing about the circumference of a body of water." Later, the novel tropes Robin's complicated merger of ahistorical pastness and futureless destiny, quote, "as an image and its reflection in the lake, which seemed parted only by the hesitation in the hour." In another example of water connecting the human and the inhuman, when Nora first meets Robin in the circus, about which more in a moment, a lioness comes to the edge of his cage, turns her head towards Robin, goes down on all fours, and, quote, "as if a river were falling behind impassable heat, the lioness's eyes flowed in tears that never reached the surface," unquote. This scene prefigures the novel's famous ending in the ruined chapel of Nora's property, where Robin goes down on all fours before Nora's dog, and then begins to fight with it as if she were herself a dog. The dog begins to cry, and Robin, for the first time, cries too, cries with him, quote, "crying in shorter and shorter spaces, moving head to head, until Robin gave up, lying out, her hands beside her, her face turned and weeping, and the dog too gave up then, and lay down, his eyes bloodshot, his head flat along her knees," unquote. Why does this final liquidation of the boundary between human and animal take place in a chapel? And not only in a chapel, but in front of, quote, "a contrived altar before a Madonna," unquote, with flowers and toys heaped at her feet and two candles burning. It is, I want to suggest, because this scene too figures a sacrament, one as powerful as the confessional, but extremely different in its performance and meaning. Baptism is practiced by various Christian sects in different ways. There's aspersion or sprinkling, there's effusion or pouring the water, there's bodily immersion where you walk in, or there's total submersion where you go in all the way. But its fundamental sign is water flowing to the head. Now, it was a sentimentalist who rewrote tears as baptismal, as a sign of forgiveness. But these tears are not a scene of washing body and soul clean, as Matthew has stroked Protestant baptism. The novel's final scene separates ablution from absolution and merges with Matthew's figure of the waters of the night. And it joins Robin's body with something finally. Whereas the connection is a technique that Foucault tells us specified individuals, isolating, intensifying, and consolidating acts into monadic identities, the baptism is fundamentally a rite of sociability, of admission to community. Its fundamental work is not on the self, whether to shore it up or just to dismantle it. Baptism not only asperses, but disperses the self. Then, too, the identity it confers, that of Christian, has little to do with the specification of individuals. There's no post-baptismal apparatus that characterizes the baptized person as a kind of Christian. Robin is baptized at the end of Nightwood in boys' clothes, by and with a dog, not only into Matthew's community of inverts, but into an unnameable interspecies social form. Moving back out again to the question of what a sacramental imaginary beyond the confessional might give us, what kind of counter-history of desire, fantasy, eros practice might emerge from thinking with the other sacraments, I want to privilege baptism's use of a physical, tangible sign, immersion in or contact with water, to figure a person's entry into a social field. And let me be clear that this social field, unlike the apparatus of sexuality, is not bound to the state. We can see this in the irony of Robin's last name, Vote, a moniker that Robin nowhere lives up to. She makes no decisions. She's a sleepwalker. And when Barracuda proposes to her, the novel tells us that she accepts this proposal as if her life held no volition for refusal. It's a very strange locution. Her baptism, through the mingling of her tears with those of animals, a sensory act, even transforms and trumps what would otherwise be her discursive consent to the sacrament of marriage. Put simply, Robin never does say yes to the Baron. She just refuses to refuse him, whereas her body fluids much more actively connect her to the dog. I also want to be clear that tangibility is the key to the novel's imagination of what might be otherwise in the regime of discourse, the palpable. Aligning with the sacrament's status as a perceptible sign in Catholic doctrine and overtaking the conceptual or the linguistic. About Robin, Felix observes this. When she touched a thing, her hands seemed to take the place of the eye. He, Felix, thought, she has the touch of the blind, who, because they see more with their fingers, forget more in their minds. Her fingers would go forward, hesitate, tremble, as if they had found a face in the dark. When her hand finally came to rest, the palm closed. It was as if she had stopped a crying mouth. Robin's hand is both eye and speaking instrument. The hand finds a crying mouth and overtakes it. Robin's touch also stays the movement of memory. Crucially, Nightwood's regime of palpability contains within it a kind of forgetting of the cognitive, or remembering of the visceral, that found the novel's alternatives to genealogy, lineal descent, and history proper. Here's one example, and it's one of the most beautiful passages in the novel. As an amputated hand cannot be disowned, because it is experiencing a futurity, of which the victim is its forebear, so Robin was an amputation that Nora could not renounce. As the wrist longed, so the heart longed. In this complex synecdoche, hand and wrist cannot be severed, but their cleaving asserts the difference between their futures. The hand is experiencing a futurity of which the wrist can only be an ancestor, and the novel doesn't believe in ancestors, I don't think. But the wrist remembers, longs, wishes itself, and extensive enough to meet the hand in a future that precludes it, or else the hand would not be amputated. And Nora actually can't renounce Robin, precisely because Robin is an amputation. Both memory and future here is cellular. But the hand, that touch that enables forgetting with the mind, though not apparently with the body, opens up the future. In seeing with the fingers, remembering with the wrist, forgetting with the hand, we see also a subtle gesture toward and yet deferral of the laying on of hands, another visible sight of the covenant that binds Christ to his people and his people to one another, and one that physically reenacts the baptism by making perceptible the binding ligaments. That's partly what the laying on of hands is doing, as we're showing the connections. The other tangible sign that in the sacramental imaginary enfolds the subject into the social in this way is, of course, the bread and wine of the Eucharist. But more so than the water of the baptism, these elements are explicitly connected to the question of memory and futurity. So here are the words that the Anglican priest, I took this out of the Book of Common Prayer, speaks of the Eucharist, quoting Christ at the Last Supper. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me. After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me. I've actually never said that out loud. There is a kind of being with the hands here, in that the cupped hands take the bread or wine, and the sensations of touch, smell, and taste trigger an ahistorical memory, one that the communicant was not present for, one outside a secular account of the past. And in fact, it's not clear that we would want to call this a memory or simply an experience of the present tense. But in any case, this physical reenactment, or enactment in the first place, connects participants to one another and to a past. As I understand it, this new covenant made with Eucharistic blood is a counter-imaginary to what we now know as the eugenic concept of race, which is to say the idea that blood connects earthly families across boundaries of both domicile and historical moment. Knighthood foregrounds this Christian technology for conjoining people beyond blood kinship and across time in ways that look deeply anti-Semitic. I mean, we just sort of have to know that about the novel. The novel's figure for blood as lineage, as kinship, as descent is to Baron Felix von Holstein, who was born on a bed stitched with the emblems of aristocracy. The canopy stamped with the bifurcated wings of the House of Habsburg, the coverlet embroidered with the folk vine arms in gold thread. Felix's father, Guido Sr., is a Jew of Italian descent whose lineage is entirely made up. His borrowed name, Folkvine, contains the figure of a biologized people of folk. He has procured a coat of arms and, quote, a list of progenitors who had never existed, unquote. And the portraits of his father and mother that eventually hang in his dining room are, quote, reproductions of two intrepid and ancient actors that he found in a dusty attic. Guido Sr. also carries the token of the 1468 running of the Jews at Corso, making him what the narrator calls, in racialized terms, quote, the sum total of what is a Jew, black with the pain of a participation that four centuries later made him the victim, as he felt the degradation by which his people have survived, end quote. Here we see the stereotype of the Jew, as Sandra Gilman has described it, figuratively black, incurably bound to racial ties, or as the novel puts it, heavy with impermissible blood, greedy, duplicitous, supplicating, and eternally victimized. Guido's son Felix seems to be on a similar trajectory. Upon hearing of his Jewish heritage, Felix becomes obsessed with old Europe, with nobility and aristocratic titles, eventually finding his people at the circus, whose pageantry, quote, linked his emotions to the higher and unattainable pageants of kings and queens, whose performers took titles as loosely and promiscuously as did his father. So it seems that the novel adds to its anti-Semitic insults the injury of associating Jews with low-rent entertainment. However, Felix's turn toward the circus before he marries Robin, the narrator surprisingly tells us, is, quote, evidence that something in his nature was turning Christian. And indeed, we meet Matthew at a party Felix attends, where Matthew's first monologue concerns a tattooed circus performer. At the same party, we also meet the arch-Protestant Nora Flood doing advanced publicity for the circus. If the characters Guido and Felix Folkvine figure Jewishness in linear terms as a false dynastic history undone by racial atavism, the circus aligns with Christianity's promisingly tangible and differential relationship to history. Now, I mean here not to counterpose Christianity to Judaism in the way that Barnes does, at the expense of Judaism, but I do mean to excavate the form and temporality of the circus where the characters meet and circulate as in many ways sacramental. Why, other than its emphasis on pageantry, is the circus sacramental? The link has everything to do with the ways that the two cultural domains conceive of bodies, language, and ultimately time. In his opening monologue at the party, Matthew contrasts history to legend, arguing that legend is what the poor man has, unexpurgated, things that happen without distinction of office or title, suggesting that legend is a form of history from the bottom up. And then he segues incongruously to describing a bear fighter in the Cirque de Paris, a man named Nika, a black man named Nika, who's tattooed all over the figures of Christianity, angels, shouts, gentleness, theory, arrow-speared hearts, monkish script, and then also with aristocracy, aphorisms from the House of Tudor, an emblem from the House of Rothschild, and then with other kind of random textual and linguistic flotsam and jetsam, the word Desdemona, a quotation from the Book of Magic, the word I on one knee and can on the other, a sailboat key to the slave trade, clasped hands. I mean, it's just sort of It's a jungle. But these signs are bound together by the tattoo of a bird carrying a bat that we guard to watch over it all. Like Nika's body, the circus is a group of bodies and images tumbled together without distinctions, unexpurgated. And in this way, both Nika and the circus are like legend. So Nightwood creates this kind of meta-daisy chain, moving from legend to circus to body and back. The other circus body that receives similar treatment is that of Frau Mann, who, as Duchess of Broadback, has an immense title like Felix's, and who also has, famously, quote, a skin that is the pattern of her costume, a bodice of lozenges, red and yellow, one somehow felt that they ran through her as the design runs through hard holiday candies, end quote. Now, rather than viewing these tattooed or patterned bodies as figures for the way discourse constructs the subject, I believe that the novel asks us to view them as the trace of the visceral in the sign, of the body in the word, of the low in the legend. What links the circus and the uterus, or rather what makes the circus into, let us say, Nightwood's first and last supper, are two things. First, the sign unexpurgated of its material aspect, and second, the function of both circus and uterus as legend other than narrative, as history other than historical, and yet not as a simple flattening out of time. Like the circus, the Eucharist is wrapped up in myth, in retelling, and the word is flesh, unabridged of flesh and bone. And Matthew, as if to echo Nietzsche, stretches that legend, like Robin's hand, to counts of forgetfulness. In other words, the crying mouse is Robin's hand that obliterates memory into mind, if it could speak, would speak the sort of story that secular history cannot capture. Something perhaps not narrative, but not for that atemporal. If Nightwood's Jew seems the problematic avatar for the secular history from which he is barred, its Christian figures a more promising version of the unhistorical. One less promising version of the unhistorical in this novel is the commodity form, a form that Barnes attributes to Christians rather than Jews. According to Matthew O'Connor, the function of the Christian is to bring up from the depth charming and fantastic superstitions through which the slowly and tirelessly known Jew once more becomes the collector of his own past. Disturbingly, here, Christians recycle histories of suffering and exclusion into objects of consumption, retelling the Old Testament as the new, in ways that exactly follow the movement of the commodity fetish. A Jew's undoing, Matthew declares, is never possible until some goy has put it back into such shape that it can be again offered as a sign. He continues, a Jew's undoing is never his own, it is God's. His rehabilitation is never his own, it is a Christian's. And of course, the commodity fetish is precisely the thing that obscures histories of suffering, the relation between owner and laborer, in a fantasy that the subject can be renewed eternally by the product. So this is certainly one way to read the sacramental, and I think the novel understands that the sacrament can be simply a kind of uncomplicated worship of the sign. Yet in Nightwood, the central objects of consumption are human bodies, which complicates things quite a bit. Barnes writes that, and this is sort of the key sentence in the sacramental imaginary of the novel, the Christian traffic and retribution has made the Jew's history a commodity. It is the medium through which he receives at the necessary moment the serum of his own past that he may offer it again as his blood. If I'm following this passage right, the image is exactly that of history as wine, as serum of the past received as a reminder of Christ's, a Jew's, suffering. Yet I also recoil at the suggestion that the Jew's history upcycled into this sign demands not Christian but Jewish blood sacrifice yet again. Especially as the theology of the Passion of Christ insists that Christ's sacrifice was made for mortal sin precisely to break the cycle of human error and God's retribution. So what is the Christian traffic and retribution? And is the novel just arguing that Jewish victimization is the bedrock of an unredeemable Eucharist? It's possible that that is indeed what Barnes would say about the Eucharist proper, tethered to church authority. But I think that the emphasis on the relationship between the Eucharist, pastness, and history suggests other, more clearly sacramental directions. The image of receiving the past through the incorporative gestures of the Eucharist is reiterated in the first account of Robin's Vote. Quote, such a woman is the infected carrier of the past. We feel that we can eat her, she who is eaten death returning, for only then do we put our face close to the blood on the lips of our forefathers. Here we see Barnes figuring the uneaten flesh, the eaten flesh, the tasted blood. Echoing the description of Frau Mann's body as hard candy, this passage offers up the possibility of eating the other as not only a movement beyond discourse, as Foucault describes friendship, two people meeting, quote, without terms or convenient words, with nothing to assure them about the meaning of the movement that carries them toward each other. So that movement, but also with time travel, of quite literally tasting the blood of the past. In other words, in Knightwood's economy of sacramental friendship, the encounter with the other must include an encounter with his or her past. Foucault's description of friendship as, quote, the formation of new alliances and the tying together of unforeseen lines of force, unquote, is perhaps not temporally thick enough, not as rich as the blood on the lips of Bonson's ancestors. What does it mean in this novel, then, to eat or drink or receive as a serum another person, their suffering, the past? What does it mean in temporal terms to be eaten up? This, I would argue, is the meat of Juno Barnes's queer sacramental imaginary. While it attributes blood concepts of race to the Jew in problematic ways, it actually proffers a model of affiliation achieved through eating the blood of a stranger. So to put it simply, in Knightwood, blood is food, not race, or at least not always race. In a talk I recently saw by Gail Anijar, he persuasively argued that the concept of racial blood is a Christian backformation attributed to Jews, but forged in the crucible of the Eucharist, where Christians drink the only pure blood that there is, the blood of Christ, and make of themselves a pure race. My contention is that Knightwood understands this, but insists upon the baptismal and Eucharistic creation of an impure people, an anti-race of counts, that that counterpoint to the regime of sexuality, which Foucault called friendship, rethought through the other sacraments, entailed not just mutuality, but also carnality and historicity. We might say that viscerally incorporating the other, or being thusly incorporated, is a kind of anti-aesthetic hosting, not a shattering of the self, but a remixing of it. One notable aspect of Knightwood, then, is that nobody eats food, though Matthew mentions that he eats salad and everybody drinks like a fish. Instead, they eat, or at least discuss eating, body parts, organs, and bones. For example, Matthew says to Nora, every man dies finally of that poison of his heart in the mouth. Yours is in your hand. Put it back. The eater of it will get a taste for you. In the end, his muzzle will be heard barking among your ribs. This echoes his earlier pronouncement about Robin and Nora, that though those two are buried at opposite ends of the earth, one dog will find them both. And the image of the eater with his muzzle in Nora's ribs prefigures the last scene in the novel, where Robin lies prone and merged with the dog. Thus, Knightwood, I want to hazard, figures a kind of jackal sacramentality. By jackal, I mean that, far from receiving the pure food of Christ's blood as a way to demarcate their difference from other communities, the characters mingle promiscuously by eating one another up like dogs. And it is Nora, again, who figures the passion of giving her body and blood to be eaten. Quote, Nora robbed herself for everyone. Incapable of giving herself warning, she was continually running about to find herself diminished. She was, by fate, one of those people who are born unprovided for, except in the provision of herself. This figure of eating impurity, of offering the body as necessarily impure because human food, throws a wrench into any fantasy of confession as communication, of language purified materiality or power relations. Then the narrator insists that Nora's, quote, good is incommunicable, that her passions, quote, make the seventh day immediate, Sunday immediate, in a way that obviates questions of belief, and that, quote, to confess to her was an act even more secret than the communication provided by a priest. She recorded, without reproach or accusation, being shorn of self-reproach or self-accusation. In the figure of a confession that is more secret than the communication provided by a priest, the pun on communication, which means both conversation and the administering of sacraments, suggests that Nora Flood offers up the Eucharist of a special kind. The body and blood offered by Knightwood's characters are not the effigies and stand-ins that the novel condemns throughout, its dolls, its false titles, its pictures of fake ancestors. Instead, its Eucharist is flesh, transubstantial. Even the sacrament of marriage gets troped in terms of a more visceral eating of the other. This is a long but beautiful quote. Such a person's every movement will reduce to an image of forgotten experience, a mirage of an eternal wedding cast on the racial memory, as insupportable joy as would be the vision of an eland coming down on an aisle of trees, chaffeted with orange blossoms and bridal veils, a hoof made of the economy of fear, stepping in the trepidation of flesh that will become myth, as the unicorn is neither man nor beast deprived, but human hunger pressing its beast to its prey. I can hardly parse this. A woman is a beast turning human. Her movements invoke not a memory, but a forgotten experience, not the real thing, but an image of that. And that image is of a wedding, projected like a screen memory over the racial memory. This wedding of man and beast is a form of the ceremony, and in the unholy union it enacts, overtakes not only race, memory, and history, the novel's bath object, but also the passage itself, as the beast becoming a woman and becomes some kind of antelope. The demon's raised hoof, in turn, figures the trembling flesh that the novel has consistently linked to legend. Here, myth then gets likened to a unicorn, who again becomes a carnal human sensation devouring a hunger. We see here another daisy chain, where the fleshiness of becoming animal blurs into becoming mythic, and then the mythic is likened to the carnal, the not remembered, the eaten prey. This tapestry of metaphors is stitched through with Eucharistic allusions. The eland is the bride of Christ, the flesh becomes a historical myth, and then human hunger. But this figure emblematizes what makes Nightwood's Eucharist different from both the confession and the commodity fetish that it otherwise seems to condemn as the central feature of Christianity. The image suggests that the proffered gift of the body may promise renewal, but it also insists that we taste and eat the suffering entailed in that renewal, and thus refuse to escape the history that hurts. The jackal sacrament, as I have called it, is a host that is a ghost in every Gordon sense. It may signal or affect God's grace, but it also signals and reanimates the past and the present. The unhistoricality of the Eucharist, as opposed to the confession, does not abolish the past and the fiction of forgiveness, but instead pulls the prior into the present or exposes the prior and the food that the present needs to sustain itself. In all, then, Nightwood moves from the confessional, whereby acts, fantasies, and desires turn into discourse, through the baptism, whereby immersion in drinking of and exchanging water enables a reconfiguration of the social, to the Eucharist, where eating and drinking dissolve both selfhood and time. Checking this, I have asked, if sexuality and its other in the project of ascesis both emerge from the rite of confession, what would the other that Foucault calls friendship look like if imagined in terms of the Eucharist? If the new historicism also emerged from a rejection of the Eucharist, what would a Eucharistic imagining of the historical look like, and what is its purchase for queer theory? I think Nightwood helps immensely in thinking about these questions. As the baptism circulates water and the Eucharist circulates wine, Nightwood suggests, queers circulate the food of the figure, itself neither pure nor impure, to be consumed by pure and impure alike. The sacramentality of Juno Barnes lies in her movement to the tangible, to the perceptible. In her version of history, we leave our body and our blood to be eaten by the dogs. So now that I've bludgeoned you with the catechism and the Nightwood, I'm happy to take answers, corrections, critiques, questions, whatever you have. Robin!
I'm not sure I understand the way that Foucault animates with the questions that you and the kind of reading you're doing with the bar.
I think
that Foucault's text is about doing history without the historical, and that part of that puts into play. So I'm not sure that the way that it seemed like it stands in as queer theory in a certain way that then has to be that you're trying to reanimate something else. And I'm just wondering whether you really need even almost that argument against Foucault to do the to have what you want to have around sacramentality.
I don't know yet, but I think one thing I would say is I don't mean to have Foucault stand in for all of queer theory, but rather to sort of have Foucault stand in for the history of sexuality insofar as that informs queer theory. I also think there is this bizarre, I think that in terms of history, you can't find in the archive what isn't in the archive. So clearly the confession produced an archive that allowed Foucault to do a certain kind of history of sexuality. But at the same time, this other thing he says about the church, which I use as my epigraph, its kind of tangibilities and its sort of, you know, splendor, doesn't yet I think fully worked out in his sense of what bodies and pleasures can do. So it's interesting to me that that's when he goes, you know, to the Greeks, or he goes to the state of masochism, rather than to the other sacraments. So I feel like, and it may be just a staging move, and again, I'm not saying at the end this is really new work, but I do think there's something kind of interesting about the secularization of the confessional, and that we don't necessarily get, I'm just going to say this in the mainstream, maybe it's not, but we don't get the secularization of the other sacraments in quite the same way. One thing I would be interested in is the question of whether SM could be thought of as secularization of the sacraments. But I sort of didn't go there. But I do think that the bodies and pleasures part of Foucault abandons the kind of, you know, habitus of religion that the confession, that the regime of sexuality uses. If that makes sense as an answer. Yeah.
So I don't know, you know, where you're going with it, but I kind of think it's a pretty bad mistake not to at least notice that the sacramentality is severely homophobic and crazily, you know, Catholic theology is really focused deeply on procreation and homosexuality, and you know, there's just sort of the valorization of the sacrament. I just kept feeling like, yes, God. And underneath all that, they put some really interesting stuff with the scams, with the you know, priests and the young boys, and you know, what is the sacramentality portrayed there, and how is the church, you know, I mean, just sort of like straightforwardly covering it up, and, you know, the post-resignation involved in all that. And I mean, I feel like Catholicism is sort of a distant subject, but for a lot of us, it's sort of painfully, and, you know, scar tissue, and to sort of deem it for queer theory without problematizing it a little worse.
Well, I sort of take it for granted that it's sort of a bad object. I mean, I worked on weddings, so I sort of figure that queer theory ought not to be avoided to objects, sort of a priori. I also think that the sacramental practices are very different than Christian doctrine, and there are any number of queer people who are incredibly attracted to the smells and bells and to the tastes and the sounds and to the kind of sensory regime that comes with Catholicism or High Church, Episcopalian, and Anglican churches, while feeling enormously skeptical about the doctrine, but for whom these rituals produce a kind of communitas that they don't actually feel in their prayer community. So you actually see, especially in the Anglican Church, a lot of sort of refugees from Catholicism, you know, for whom the doctrinal stuff has been totally unpalatable, and who move to, especially the American Episcopal Church, as a place that asks more questions than it has answers. There is a fundamentalist wing of it in the other church, but who in part make that move because that sensory apparatus of capitalism, that's an interesting word, of Catholicism, you know, does feel like home and feel like blood and feel like community and feel like family. So I would really want to make a separation between the blah blah about what the sacraments are for, you know, and the practice of receiving, administering, participating in these sort of rituals. And I guess, you know, part of my own critical impulse is to say people aren't stupid. They don't have weddings, or they don't go to, you know, church because they're idiots and they haven't figured out that this is bad for them. They go because these rituals and scenes and objects are producing forms of knowledge or producing forms of possibility that they don't necessarily feel in other parts of their life. And then it takes a certain disaggregation of the object to find out what the kind of utopian part of that is. You know, so when I worked on weddings, it was really, oh, weddings, they're this mishmash of the histories of institutional control of the marriage, custom, church, state, and commodity culture. And each of these places that controls marriage has a different imagination for what kinship could be. And so a wedding, as opposed to marriage law, will actually stage some of those things and make them sort of visible and visceral and viable for people. And that must be one reason people have weddings. It can't, you know, there must be one reason weddings have some kind of affect or an effect besides just kind of consolidating couplehood. So I feel the same way about the sacraments. I mean, I actually like to sort of move towards an object that looks like it's unredeemable, but that people use as a knowledge practice or as a practice of community and see what happens. So that would be, I mean, I knew that people are like, why Christianity? Why sacraments? Why are you doing this? The church is patriarchal. But I feel like I think there are studies to decide in advance that an object is not worth analysis. I also think that one of the interesting things about what we just said about the church is that the confessional turns out to be the place where a lot of abuse happens, right? You know, the confessional is a place of great secrecy and a place where people, there's utter confidentiality, you know, and so it produces the possibilities for scandal that I don't think the Eucharist actually does in quite the same way. Yeah?
There are those boys, that's
but I'm putting on the altar.
So, I mean, one of the interesting things about this that reminds me of Schoenberg, of the work is that your object of Barnes' knighthood is like a co-producer of your analysis.
Yeah.
So, my question is actually not about that because I could get past the first few pages and later, whatever. So, it's actually, if you're proposing something that's more mobile, and if you're proposing something that's more mobile, this kind of relates to Kathy's question a little bit, you kind of need, you know, you need a book to be Catholic. You kind of need the church to have those objects and transfers and energies. Well, you need the Holy Spirit being in the church to animate, to give those things power. And so that's not necessarily including or even power necessarily, but whatever you want to do with it. So, I mean, basically, you have the sacraments without the church.
Well, I thought about that. I mean, I think, I don't know because there's a certain amount of, it is the sacrament that's authorized in certain ways, but I do wonder if you can have sacramental energies that have to do with the fantasy or the practice of merging bodies or giving parts of the body or the kind of regime of shared shared consumption or shared intake, right? That wouldn't under Catholic theology count as sacraments? They couldn't. But is there a way to? And it's hard to know. We just still want to name it sacramental. And honestly, I don't know yet. But I think that there are things going on with sacramental practices that feel much bigger than what authorizes them. And so I think that's part of the question about can you have religion without religion? Can you have post theological sacramentality? And I would like to say provisionally that you could, or that the sacrament is good to speak with, right? But that, and that what you think with it might go beyond the church. You know, does it remain legibly sacramental? I don't know. I mean, I think that I was talking to some relatives at lunch about this question of the kind of earnest devotional energy of some, say, SM practices. You know, which don't feel to me just like a way of profaning or flouting the kind of religious apparatus that we use. They feel very much like inhabiting them and using them for something different. They don't feel just like the profane. So I want to go with that a little bit. I want to sort of say that there are devotional practices and sacramental energies that may, at the end of the day, not be so tightly tethered to the church. It may be that sacrament's not the right word for them at the end of the day, but I'm risking it right now. Yeah.
Well, to think about religion, I think about have you thought about other religions like Pentecostal?
Not yet. I mean, part of it was the sort of go where you know.
I mean, Pentecostal, not that I know that much about it, but talk about merging the different.
Well, that's right. And I, you know, and I'm, I don't know enough about the
right.
I know it's speaking in tongues.
You're like that's a temporality.
Yeah, and it may be sort of ultimately. I mean, one thing would be to say, you know, what of sacramentality does Pentecostalism retain? To what extent does it depend for its means and understanding on some earlier, you know, Christian ritual? And to what extent does it depart from them? I would want to know a little bit more about that. Anglo-American ecstatic rituals as well. But I feel like that partly requires a kind of historical argument that I just haven't sort of been able to do. Like I said, sort of random work. And I would be interested in the question of whether Pentecostals themselves understand what they're doing as having to do with the sacraments, or having to do with some of the same things that Catholics say that the sacraments do. I don't know, Irish, you might know.
No. I mean, before they did the queers, they did Catholics more.
Yeah. Well, in part, but this is the other thing, and again, you might have more to say about the question of Pentecostalism than I could. I do want to kind of hold out for a vision of queer that doesn't depend on bodily immediacy, that really does, like I think of queer as doing things with figures. Now, it can't be only that, or it's just whatever, aesthetic, but I think it can't not be that either, that there's some way that the relationship between queers and cultural making has had everything to do with the play and the risk and the fun of figuration and of ritual and of object. And so I don't know what the Pentecostal relationship to that is. In other words, is Pentecostalism fundamentally iconoclastic at the end of the day, or does it have its own versions of sort of iconophilia? And would we want to claim those as queer or not? Yeah, sure.
I was just thinking, at one point you said something about how certain ritual formations, I forget the word, I wrote it down, mm-hmm. are changed, and you want to think of geographically too, mm-hmm. about the Americas in particular, mm-hmm. and one of the obsessions in queer conservatives for the Mormon church and the Mormon church in particular, and I was wondering, there's been a lot of reprisal now, talk about person first, etc., because of HIV/AIDS in our generation, kind of not talking about it mm-hmm. as much as as later generations seem to want to. And I was just wondering if you were thinking at all about, if you were thinking about genealogies in this country, if you thought something about some of it.
Well, I worked in the Mormons long before I worked on Sacramento, you know, and what was interesting to me about the Mormons and the sort of set of social cultural experiments that happened during the Second Great Awakening was precisely the this completely different sort of imaginary for kinship. You know, and it's a bit like, as I said, Mormonism, enormously patriarchal, right? The practice of kind of fundamentalist Mormonism is deeply problematic, and yet Mormon theology and Mormon ritual can produce these really complicated forms of affiliation, you know, which seemed to me when I was working on Mormons to be enormously promising to think with, even though that didn't mean sort of advocating that what the Mormons are doing right now is great, you know, across the board. In terms of genealogies, I mean,
I was just thinking you were doing a fair bit of that. It seemed to be a small part of your argument.
A small part of
the argument, your argument. Today.
Which what seemed to be a small part of
that moment when you're talking about genealogies or American.
Right. And I don't know, because I'm thinking about sacraments and Foucault, I don't yet know kind of where does that meet American religious experiment and religious experience. I mean, I suspect that partly the place that I know anything about sacramentality is the Episcopal Church, which is the American version of the Anglican Church. I don't yet know what are some differences in the sacramental imaginaries of the two. I've certainly read all this stuff. My partner is clergy, so I partly came into this just in this like completely unchurched way, going to see what my partner did and what her people thought about and did, and being actually kind of astonished by the way that the Eucharist in particular was powerful for people who were activists in ways that, frankly, academics that I knew were not. You know, who were doing on the ground kinds of political work, caretaking, advocacy. And I just thought, why? Like, what is it? Why is the Eucharist so moving? What does it symbolize to someone who has, you know, an overtly recognizably what we would know, what all of us would agree is political imagination? So that is partly my perception starting where you know. But I'm not sure, I use the Catholic Catechism because it's the most sort of rigorous about sacraments. But again, when I came to the Eucharist, I turned to the Book of Common Prayer because the language is simpler and sort of easier. But I don't know yet, maybe the people who are in religious studies can help fill in this question of what happens to the sacraments as they travel overseas. Right.
something all I want to offer up is just a reference that you might find fruitful for your own thinking. It's by a theologian, her name is Shawn Cope. Mm-hmm. She wrote a book called Flesh and Freedom, Race, Class, Something, I forget her term. Mm-hmm. And she's an African-American woman. It's a kind of query of Eucharist. And it's a really interesting text. I kept thinking of this text every time. There are many points in the argument. I think you might find it very interesting.
Flesh and Freedom?
It's called Flesh and Freedom.
And Flesh and Flesh.
In Flesh. And I should say as well, because her text is also could be an interesting text to think with, because in many ways it's a theological text, but inside the theological text, it's really a kind of commentary, a kind of meditation on Toni Morrison's Beloved.
Yeah.
And it's trying to argue, and it's sort of making a kind of covert argument that what we need to sort of take Morrison's own kind of Catholic sensibility seriously in her own work. And what she tries to do is read the sort of operations of flesh inside of Toni Morrison's text by way of Eucharist and what it opens up. I think you might find
that interesting.
I mean, one of the things that, so in the work that I'm doing now, each chapter of this thing that might be able to require me to suddenly have a crash course in a brand new field. So I have a piece on criticism and chronic time, and suddenly I'm reading tons of medical anthropology. And so this one, I'm like, oh my God, I'm reading theology and I'm reading, you know, early Christian history. So thank you, that's immensely helpful. And then I also wonder, you know, so the American history of the church involves the African American church so deeply. And again, I don't know enough about the genealogy of kind of body practices having to do with shout and food and contact, you know, to what extent, you know, what's their genealogical relationship to something like Catholicism, which is close to other possible genealogies, but that's something really people are
So, I don't think I have any problem with you using the sacraments and moving them in a different direction, as you say. SM, I believe, already does that, and I don't think it is to justify the sacraments. But I'm wondering why the Eucharist specifically, and actually, I'm wondering why not. Why we can't generalize out from there to cannibalism in general, to rituals of cannibalism, why you haven't gone there. Because it really seems to me that when we think about rituals of cannibalism, for the most part, that's about ingesting the other, ingesting strangers, often. For the most part, it's about changing the self. It often is about moving beyond the time of your own time into some sort of relationship with the gods. So I'm wondering why.
I think that's sort of towards the end where I'm going, and it may be where I end up going, and who knows what will get knocked off. I always read a text to think whether the limits of the text or that it can imagine sort of feeding the dogs, but it doesn't really outward into another imagining about what it means to people. It seems to me to be ultimately very Catholic Protestant. I think one way to do that, and again, something I thought to me to have already done and done better than I could do it, but it's this sort of question of to what extent, I'm just thinking out loud. So much work has been done on questions of the fetish, right? Commodity fetishism, anthropological fetishism, racism inherent in ideas about fetishism. You know, is that, with that, what would happen if you put being rather than sort of idol worship at the center of that kind of thinking? Might be a really interesting direction to go. I mean, I think one simple answer is I haven't gone there yet, but another might be that it would need to come from a very different kind of angle and through anthropological literature, would it end up in the same place? I don't know. I mean, I certainly think I would like to think it would end up in a queer place, but I don't know if it would be the same place. I think that's a really fruitful intervention.
One thing about cannibalism, not that I'm an expert on cannibalism, but I'm not sure it's necessarily that you consume strangers.
I'm not sure.
I think sometimes it's if people who you have, who have incredible power, and in part you're trying to adjust the power.
Right. So, and also ancestral too, mm-hmm. and some people for instance have something to questions like ancestry.
I mean, but it's certainly there's a different kind of affiliation. I mean,
it is
not kin. Absolutely. But you know, the father.
Sort of at the nexus of these questions about performing the sacrament and consuming the other in an intimate way, I was wondering if you had thought at all about thinking of Twilight?
Oh, you think of Twilight. You might think better about it. Well, I mean, I can certainly think, and this isn't Twilight, so I'm going to come up to being not very well versed in Twilight, whatever that makes me. I think what it makes me is someone who has a small child, and so you know, the whole bibliography is useless stuff, and not yet Twilight. I'm thinking about like the early queer work on the vampire, you know, like the little case and stuff, you know, did like want to hold the sense that you need the blood of the other and kind of consumption of the flesh of the other was a way to break down a certain kind of bodily boundaries and really identity categories, I think, more in that kind of imagination. So I think you can bring that to bear upon Twilight easily enough, for sure. But not being well-versed in Twilight, what would you say?
Well, I think there's a lot of criticism that Twilight is sort of dequeuing the vampire and sort of putting it into the service of the
more heteronormativity. Yeah.
So I actually thought it might be interesting.
Well, there is a query with that. There's a little bit of Hansen's piece, which I'm not remembering the title of, but On the Undead. So there was a kind of, and I do think, like, I'm starting to see stuff at GLQ on queer zombies, and this, like, the zombie relationship being like this cannibal sacramental imaginary that I'm coming up. I think that I do, though, I have a tendency not to want to go towards the thing that kind of looks automatically the most radical, and I think, like, that just might be a perversion. You know, that I'm like, but that's easy to know about vampires, or that's easy to know about zombies, and kind of less easy to know about normative practices. And I do think that I'll just talk to this. Like, I am interested in normative practices. I am interested in unpacking them and in not assuming that people who engage in them are unenlightened morons. You know, I don't find the kind of immediate reaction, negative reaction to normativity to be critically very useful. So that is why I wanted to risk annoying or offending with something like the sacraments, because I think it seems to me to be easy enough to please people with, you know, with something that seems sort of sexier and more radical. So there's always a risk. I mean, I remember I was working on weddings, it's like that's not a top one, that's not a topic, and two, it's totally normative, and why would you do that? And, you know, okay, because I, from the very beginning, was unsatisfied with a certain, what I think of the modernist move towards the anti-normative, seemed to be me. So,
thank you very much.
Thank you!